Father, we take a few moments to calm our hearts. We'd ask that right now your Holy Spirit would be present within this building, working within our hearts. Open your word and teach us. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Whether I go to Giant Eagle, Bueller's, or Acme, I see it everywhere. In the National Enquirer or the Star magazine, Jennifer Aniston. I feel so bad for her. Beautiful, young, talented, successful actress. And I don't know what happens, no matter who she marries or who she has a relationship with. All these guys dump her. I don't understand it. And everybody wants to read about it. Now, part of me thinks it's emotional voyeurism. But another part of me thinks that people are saying, I don't feel so bad about myself. If somebody like her can't keep a relationship together, I feel pretty good about myself. And then I think of Kim Kardashian. I see her picture everywhere. And I ask, what does she do? Why is she famous? It seems like she's famous for being famous. I know that she used to sell celebrities' things on eBay. I know that she had a sex tape scandal. That's where I've heard she's made her money. And one time, somebody roped me into watching 10 minutes of Keeping Up with the Kardashians. And for 10 minutes, I watched Kim Kardashian looking for a lost earring and sat there just like this. Why do people watch it? But they love looking at her. They love, you know, I mean, she's an attractive woman, but I don't know what she can do. And I think that a lot of us like to look at Kim Kardashian because we say, here's somebody who's hit it big. They have fame, fortune, wealth, and riches. And you know what? They produce nothing. I want to be like that. And then what is it with our culture and vampires and zombies? Vampires and zombies. Zombies, The Walking Dead. I've watched that show a couple times. And I just sit there and I go, what is it with this? There's these lifeless, soulless, lawless people with no brains just attack living, innocent people. And I say to myself, maybe that's because the zombies kind of represent what a lot of us fear our entire culture is becoming. Mindless, lawless people who attack the innocent. And I think maybe a zombie is kind of an archetype. And we like to watch that because in some deep psychological way, we're saying, this is what our culture's turning into. Yeah, we think it's funny here, but this is what people do. This is what our culture's becoming. And vampires, dead, soulless people who survive by sucking the life out of other people. A vampire sort of makes a relationship agreement. And it says, I'll have a relationship with you if you let me suck the life out of you. And then the host says, I'll let you suck the life out of me just as long as you protect me and let me have a relationship with you and you don't abandon me. Now some of you are thinking, oh, vampires. You have somebody that sucks the life out of you. Oh, you're talking about work and employment. No. Others of you are saying, no, he's talking about marriage. No. But a vampire, I think, is another archetypal image. We like it because there are vampires all around us. People who attach themselves to somebody and suck the life out of them, and when there's nothing left, they move on to someone else. And so we think of them as a monster on TV, but in reality, they represent real people in our lives that we have to deal with. Now, the stories of vampires and zombies, they've been around for centuries, some millennia. And I think they're all illustrations of the types of evil people that are identified in the book of Proverbs. And Proverbs is a book that shows us how to find godly wisdom to make our way through life. In many ways, it was written as a father's instruction to his son, to a young child, a young man, or a young daughter. And it's also Solomon talking in the book of Proverbs, even nationally saying, for the child of God, this is what you need to know to get along in life. And so the book of Proverbs, and we'll be in Proverbs chapter 2 today, talks about how to be shrewd, how to find godly wisdom. Now, I have to apologize for the outline. I even said to Beverly when I wrote this, I said, I don't know, I usually don't go for rhymey stuff, but I kept saying the shrewd dude, the shrewd. Now that's just embarrassing to me, because I tend to be real analytical and factual, so please just kind of ignore my little attempt there. I even said to her, I said, you know, I don't know about this. But at the time, it amused me. Now I look at it and go, oh. But how do I avoid those vampires and the zombies in life? And we're going to look at Proverbs chapter 2 today, where we're going to see four rewards of godly wisdom. Four rewards of being morally shrewd that'll keep us from falling prey to evil men and evil women, zombies and vampires. And there can be male zombies, female zombies. There can be male vampires, female vampires. So Solomon wrote this as addressing a son. And he said in Proverbs 2, in the whole section, verses 1 through 12, he says, wisdom from God will make you shrewd. Now, usually when you think of shrewd, you think of somebody who's manipulative. But here, God is saying, no, you need to be able to figure out what's going on in life. Even Jesus said, I send you out in Matthew 10. He says, I send you out as sheep among wolves. Therefore, be as innocent as doves and as wise as a serpent. He's saying, you need to be shrewd as you go out there. Even Solomon is saying, you need to be shrewd. Understand what people want to do. Turn your ear to wisdom. Let's read through verses 1 through 4. My son, if you accept my words and store up my commands within you, turning your ear to wisdom and applying your heart to understanding, and if you call out for insight and cry aloud for understanding, and if you look for it as for silver and search for it as for hidden treasure, then you will understand the fear of the Lord and find the knowledge of God. Turn your ear towards wisdom. It's an internal thing that you do, an internal inclination to accept it, to submit to it. And it says, store up my commands within you. Now, instantly, I think of Psalm 119:11. Thy word I have hid in my heart that I might not sin against you. In many ways, it sounds like he's saying, memorize Scripture, consume Scripture. And I would say, I think that's a good way to interpret that. But at the same time, I think memorizing Scripture and trying to use Bible verses almost as magic charms against Satan or evil, I don't think that works. Now, some of you will say, oh, wait a second. I know Matthew chapter 4, right after Jesus was baptized, he spent 40 days in the wilderness and he fasted. And when Satan approached him, you know, there were four times he said in Matthew 4:7, 4:10, it is written, it is written, it is written. And he defeated Satan with Scripture. Absolutely he did. After 40 days of agonizing obedience and calling out and crying out to God. One of the things I remember in Warsaw, Indiana, when I lived there, a fellow who was really dealing with problems of lust went to the pastor and he said, Mike, this just isn't working. He gave me these three verses to memorize. He said, if I just memorize these verses and repeat them over and over and over, I won't have any more problems. But it just isn't working. I said, no, because you need to get involved in a life and death struggle with this. To just say a Bible verse as a magic charm does not work. Because when you take a step of obedience and put your feet towards that verse, It's going to involve pain. It's going to involve a fight with Satan. And yes, the power of God will come and work within you, and the power of God will use those scriptures. But you have to put your whole heart into it. It's not a magic charm to say it, and then the problem goes away, and you go, huh, well, that's all I've got to do. There's no struggle to this at all. Turn your ear. Listen to another. Turn your ear to wisdom. Apply your heart to understanding. Your entire heart is the most important word dealing with mankind in the Bible, because the heart is all you are, material and immaterial. You know, there's a proverb that says, follow your heart, but take your brain with you. If you'd have said that to Solomon, he'd have gone, I don't understand. There's only your heart. Everything comes from the heart. They had no idea what the brain did. They just knew that the heart of the person was this. This is where the will, the emotions, everything that made you a person was here in the heart. It's all you are. And so it says, everything that's who you are on the inside, apply it to knowing God. And then after you've done all of this internally, now you have an external application to this. Verses 3 and 4, and if you call out for insight and cry aloud for understanding, if you look for it as silver and search for it as hidden treasure, then you will understand the fear of the Lord and find the knowledge of God. Call out, cry aloud, look and search. I mean, this involves activity. If I said right now, somewhere in this room, I have a gold Krugerrand, and if you know the price of gold per ounce right now, you know it's hovering right about $1,150 an ounce, and I've taped it somewhere. It goes to whoever finds it. I've got a feeling that every one of you would be scrambling. I want that. I want that. I want that. You'd look for it. You'd search for it. And so Solomon is saying, when it comes to wisdom to know how to handle life and to fight against evil, you've got to look for wisdom to know how to do this. Like, how many of you here can ride a bike? How many of you here can swim? How many of you here have learned to do either of those two things by reading a book? Doesn't work. You have to apply yourself and throw your whole self into it. Do you think that true spirituality comes from just reading a book? You can read it and read it and read it. If you never apply it, it won't change your life. Just like learning how to ride a bike or learning how to swim, you have to do it. And you know what? Learning how to swim, you swallow a little water, don't you? I just learned how to swim 2 years ago. Believe me, I know all about swallowing pool water. And riding a bike. Who has done it and just jumped on the first time and it's been perfect? No, you fall. You get scraped up. There's scary work when you turn inclinations into reality. And turning this book and turning your life to a place of having godly wisdom and godly shrewdness, it means it's going to take work if you want to be a godly person. And some of it's going to be scary work. Now, wisdom is understanding the fear of God. That's what it means to be spiritually shrewd. Verses 5 through 8. Then you will understand the fear of the Lord and find the knowledge of God. For the Lord gives wisdom from his mouth comes knowledge and understanding. He holds victory in store for the upright. He is a shield to those whose walk is blameless. For he guards the course of the just and protects the way of his faithful ones. This is an if-then relationship. If you search for him with all you are on the inside. If you search for him and externally search and look and call aloud and cry out, then he will answer and his ways are better. You will find the knowledge of God. You'll find true spirituality, which is to know the right thing to do the right thing, to do it motivated by love for God, to do it dying to self in the process, and having the power of Jesus Christ, a man who rose from the dead, come into your life and raise you up as a new person in power and change you, that's understanding the fear of God. That's wisdom. That's true spirituality. And the Lord gives wisdom. You need to incline your heart towards it, though, to change how you think and say, he's got a better idea. And there's victory there. He's a shield for the blameless, not the sinless, but the blameless. He's a guard for the just, protecting the faithful. And wisdom will protect. Verses 9 through 11, wisdom will protect you. Then you will understand what is right and just and fair, every good path. For wisdom will enter your heart and knowledge will be pleasant to your soul. Discretion will protect you and understanding will guard you. Understanding from God's perspective shows you what's right and just and fair. And what's fair may not always be what you want. What's fair sometimes is not pleasant for you, but pleasant for somebody else. A while back, I'd gone to Jubilee Donuts and got some donuts for the family. And I don't know why, I knew exactly how much money I had going in there. And when I came back, I said, I've got $10 too much. Well, they gave me too much change. And my first thought was, well, I think of every time that I've been, you know, overcharged in something like this. This is just me getting even. You know, I thought, no, you've got to take this back. You've got to take it back. A week later, I went in. Same girl was at the register. Went up to her and I said, you don't remember me, but a week ago, I bought a dozen donuts here, and I'll bet that your cash register was $10 off at the end of the day. And she just went, oh. I said, yeah, you gave me $10 too much. Here's the $10. And she went, oh. And her friend, who she must have gotten into trouble, her friend goes, thank you so much for bringing that back. I haven't been there since. But that was the fair thing to do. Yeah, isn't it nice when sometimes you get an extra $10? But it's not fair for the other person that's out the money. Now, if it had been $1,000, I might not have. No, let's say I would have. Wisdom will enter your heart. Wisdom is saying, how do my actions affect other people? Instead of, how do my actions benefit me? You start to think, you know, how do my actions benefit others? And then it says, discretion will protect you. You'll be able to analyze the facts. You'll be able to take a situation and break it down into component parts, connect the dots, and understand people's motives. And once you have spiritual shrewdness, then you will have protection from the evil men. Protection from the people who would be like zombies. And this could be evil women as well, in verses 12 to 15. Verse 12, he says, "These wisdom will save you from the ways of wicked men, from men whose words are perverse." That means turned from what's right and good, corrupt. Perverse words would be words like Satan spoke to Eve. Really? Has God really said this? Has God said you shouldn't eat from that? Well, you won't die. Well, if you eat this, you'll be just as wise as God. Those are perverse words. They don't sound really bad. Most of us think of perversion and we think of something, you know, just gross and sexual. But perverse words are words that do not square with the truth. Perverse words that you say to yourself are, I can have it both ways. Perverse words compete with the godly words of a parent saying, this is the right way to do things. And you need to tell your children, parents and grandparents, that as your children go out into the world, there's going to be a lot of competition for your instruction saying, has your mom and dad really said, oh, if you do this, you won't get hurt. It'll be good for you. In fact, you'll become just as wise as them. You'll be able to enjoy just as much of life as they do. They just don't want you to enjoy anything. Really, is Satan's tactic a whole lot different than it was 10,000 years ago? No. And these are either evil people who've abandoned the covenant. It says these are evil men who leave the straight paths to walk in dark ways, who delight in doing wrong and rejoice in the perverseness of evil, whose paths are crooked and who are devious in their ways. They've abandoned the straight paths, the covenant with God. In many cases, these are people who've been brought up in a covenant home, a Christian home. It would be like the prodigal son, brought up in a godly home, decided to go another direction. Like Cain and Esau, brought up in a home where there were God-fearing parents, decided to go another way. And even for a time, Jacob himself, he deceived Esau, Isaac, and Laban. And these are guys that walk in darkness, and they rejoice in evil. In many ways, they're just like Milton's Satan in Paradise Lost, where Satan says, "Evil, be thou my good." And these are men of crooked words and actions. Anybody ever been approached by somebody with crooked words and crooked actions? One of the worst fellows that ever approached me happened in 1975 in Coventry Village. And Dave Jensen was with me when it happened. Do you remember Richard? Yes, he remembers Richard. Dave and I just went up to Coventry, looking around, and we've met a friend of mine. This friend had a brother named Richard. They were moving things. Neither Dave or I was employed at the time, and they said, "Hey, we'll pay you some cash if you will help us move this furniture." Dave and I said, "What a deal! Sure, we'll do it." Richard said, "I'll take him," pointed at me. We started to drive. Little did I know at the time that Richard was a very aggressive proponent of the gay lifestyle. And we were in the car, and one of the first things he said to me was, "So, where are you from?" I said, "Rittman." He said, "Do you have any drag queens down there?" And I'm sitting there going, "Drag queens, drag queens." All I could think of was, I've been to Dragway 42 several times, but it's mostly guys who drive. I've never seen a girl drive. And he goes, no, guys dressed up as girls. And I'm still going, well, why would anyone do that? You know. So, you know, the next thing I know, he's just coming on saying, "I think we should do something." I said, "I don't think we should." And I'm sitting there going, he kept just, oh, it was just perverse, crooked words. And I remember his last salvo, and I said in my mind, "No, that is my final word." And I thought to myself, "If you touch me, it will take you 6 months to recover." I didn't say that, but in my mind it was like, "One finger goes on me, I will break you apart." You know, and that was the end of it, you know. And I don't know what it is, but since that time, I get approached a lot by gay guys. And I've never quite Suzanne has watched it happen. And I sit there and I go, how come girls don't like me like this? You know, it's always the guys. You know, I don't, what do I do? There are people like that who are going to come after your children. Have you told them about that? Have you told them about people with crooked words and crooked ways who will approach them? They need to know before it happens. And do you think that's going to be a pleasant subject to bring up at the dinner table? But if you don't, who will? Mom, dad, grandparents, if you don't bring it up, who will? No one. They'll hear it from the evil guy. Is that who you want to have your child approached by for the first time? I don't. And I know when I start these conversations with my kids, it's like, you know, "Oh, here we go again. Dad's at it. We're getting preached at now. He's going to start." You've got to say it. Somebody's got to say it. Wisdom will protect you from that type of a person, and it's the parents' job to build that wisdom in. It also says that wisdom will protect from the adulteress. Verses 16 through 19. It will also save you from the adulteress. And I would say here, adulteress, adulterer. Male or female, just right here, it went to the woman. From the wayward wife with her seductive words, who has left the partner of her youth and ignored the covenant she made before God. For her house leads down to death and her path to the spirits of the dead. None who go to her return or attain the paths of life. Now, I've got a feeling a lot of you are sitting there going, oh, come on, does this really need addressed? I mean, we're talking about church here. Do Christians really struggle with this kind of stuff? Can't we just skip this? Let me ask you, have any of you heard of a fellow by the name of John Gibson? Does that name mean anything to anybody? John Gibson. He was in the news 6 weeks ago. A pastor, family man, loved, successful ministry, committed suicide. Does anybody know why he committed suicide? Has anybody ever heard of this? Ashley Madison. He was a pastor who was on the Ashley Madison website. Ashley Madison is a website for married people who just aren't getting what they want out of their marriage and they want to have an affair. 37 million people in there, 70% men, 30% women. And their motto is, life is short, have an affair. What happened was a bunch of hackers got into the Ashley Madison website and then started to blackmail Ashley Madison about 2 to 3 months ago, saying, you give us this amount of money and we'll keep your list of clients quiet. Otherwise, we're going to out all of these people. Oh, Ashley Madison didn't pay. And about 400 pastors and church elders had their names come out. And a lot of them resigned their ministries. A lot of them quit their churches. And one man, John Gibson, it was so horrible, he committed suicide. Ashley Madison. Why did they join the site? This is what they say about it. I just don't have any passion left in my marriage. My spouse just isn't even interested in me, and they have no time for me. The spouse loves work more than me now. The spouse just comes home and plops, never wants to do anything. I don't want a divorce. I just want to feel wanted and attractive and loved and valued and pursued. And there's nothing wrong with wanting to feel that way. But how you go after it is a different thing. Now, half of you may be listening to this and going, that is so stupid. And the other half of you are going, that's exactly how I feel. He's saying exactly how I feel right now. I don't like it when somebody's up there saying that's exactly how I feel. The Journal of Relational and Couples Therapy says 50% of married women will have an affair. 60% of married men will have an affair. So I would say that adultery is alive and well in the 21st century. And that's a subject that Solomon addresses here with his child, and it's a subject that parents need to address with their children. Don't listen to the words of evil men, and don't listen to the words of the adulteress or the adulterer. You need to be telling your daughters, there are evil men out there who will say anything to get what they want. And men, you'd have to agree with me. We're all dogs, aren't we? Women, you know it. Men, you need to tell your daughters, watch out for guys. Moms, you need to tell your daughters, watch out for guys. You need to tell your sons, watch out for aggressive girls. Seductive words, they will say. From the wayward wife with her seductive words, smooth words. Do you know in Psalm 55, verses 20 to 21, it reads, my companion attacks his friends. He violates his covenant. His speech is smooth as butter, yet war is in his heart. His words are more soothing than oil, yet they are drawn swords. It's the same words here where it talks about, you know, her seductive, smooth words, the man's seductive or smooth words. It sounds smooth, but they are drawn swords. Now, I think probably the best illustration of watching someone seduced and the smooth words of having it done were probably captured in the 1967 Oscar award-winning film, The Graduate, where you saw Mrs. Robinson slowly and methodically seduce Benjamin. Benjamin sat there the first time she brought up the idea, although very subjectively. He says, Mrs. Robinson, you're trying to seduce me. And she just sat there and looked, oh, what makes you think that? And another time, he is in her bedroom, and she's saying, Benjamin, could you unzip me? Oh, no, you're trying to seduce me. Which she says, Benjamin, I am not trying to seduce you. Just come and unzip me. And eventually, Benjamin says, okay. And so begins his descent. Moms and dads need to tell your kids, this is how it will happen. This is what you need to know to say, I know what's going on. I've got to get out of here. The adulteress or the adulterer tells you what you want to hear, oftentimes creating an emotional affair before a physical affair. Have you ever heard the term emotional affair? Sometimes you can enter into an emotional affair and nothing physical is going on. It's just all of a sudden you realize, you wake up one day and you say, good grief. I'm in love with this person at work. I'm married to my wife and I love her. And now I'm in love with someone else. How did this happen? Probably somebody was saying things to you that you wanted to hear. And it went straight to your heart. This is where a parent needs to say to their child, this is a danger that's ahead of you. Watch out. This woman has left the partner of her youth, the person they married and they first had sex with, the first person they imprinted with. You know, 10 years ago, my daughter and I incubated duck eggs. I found a nest that had a dozen eggs in it. I took three of them, brought them home, made an incubator. And Lauren and I would come home, she'd come home from school, and we'd go down and we'd look at the eggs. We'd turn the eggs every day, and we'd sit there and watch them. And one day, all three eggs, we heard it. They were breaking out of the shells. So we just sat there and watched them. And as these little ducks broke out of their shells, the first two people they saw were Lauren and myself. So she and I were mommy. Those ducks imprinted on us and followed us everywhere. I mean, we had a little cage for them upstairs. And I tell you, if you've never had ducks running around in your house, it's great fun. Sometimes the cleanup isn't so good, but it was really great. But they trusted that person they imprinted on. Now, do you know that God has set us up? And see, this is again, talking to your children about this, not really the most comfortable thing, but it needs to be said. God has set us up. Sex is so powerful. We imprint on our first partner. And that's why sex before marriage is so destructive, because the way it's supposed to work is you save yourself, the guy saves himself, the girl saves herself, and then you get married, and that's the first person you've ever experienced a physical relationship with. Now, from that point on, you're saying, you're the only one I've ever known, you're the only one I'm ever going to want. That's how it's supposed to work. But for a lot of us, hasn't worked that way. And we need to be honest with our kids and say, this is how it's supposed to work. Don't listen to this person who says, you know, oh no, has your father really said that? Did your dad really say that you should keep yourself? I mean, that's not what guys do. Guys run around. Don't listen to what your dad says. There's always going to be those perverse words to challenge goodness. What happens if mom or dad are never even given the instructions from the get-go? What if they never hear the other side of the argument and all they hear is, hey, this is fun. It says this woman ignored the covenant that she made before God. Do you know marriage is not getting a state license? Do you know that state licenses for marriages didn't even exist until the 30s? You used to just get married in a church. That's all you needed. Do you know why they started giving marriage licenses out? Social Security. It's the only reason we give marriage licenses now from the state. But a marriage is not a state license. It isn't a reception, how cool of a reception you have. It's not how the church is decorated. It's not the particular church you're married in. It's not the fashion statement that's made by the bride and the groom. I mean, 3 weeks ago, I was at a wedding. It was the most expensive wedding I've ever been at. There were 4 bands. There were 2 meals. First, there was the wedding at the church, and there was a choir and a band that played up in the loft. Then they served you lunch, and there was another band that played for lunch. Then there was about a 2 or 3 hour gap. Then you went to the reception hall. And then there was another band that greeted you at the reception hall, and then a 4th band that played for the dance later that night. I was sitting there with my wife going, well, this has got to be $40,000, don't you think? You know, we're trying to tabulate the thing. But with all of that, and I mean, it was a beautiful wedding as far as how everything was planned. The only thing that really made the wedding a wedding was that 3-minute block of time where the bride and the groom were facing each other and the priest was there and they said, okay, for richer, for poorer, for better or for worse, in sickness and in health, till death do you part. And that's where I sit there going, this is the marriage right here. Everything else is just fluff. This is the marriage. I want to hear it. I want to hear it. And when I hear, I do, I know that's a promise between these two people and God, with everybody else there as a witness. That is the marriage. But the way it looks to everybody else, that's really very little. The rest is just the party. And I sit there going, no, it's the covenant. It's the covenant that you're making. Solomon is clear. The results of the affair are death, death, death. And I think this is a man who's speaking from experience. A man who we see in the book of Ecclesiastes had 700 wives and 300 concubines. I think this man was speaking from moral failure. And he was saying, listen, my son, you want to see how not to do it? Follow my life. Let me tell you how it should be done. When I talked about the wicked men, it didn't say death, 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 because there I think, you know, well, they're lying, they're defrauding, they're stealing. Everything is kind of thing-oriented most of the time. But here, when it comes to this sin, it's saying, no. Adultery breaks a covenant with God, with your spouse. It'll bring divorce around. It'll tear people apart, and that's such an awful pain to go through. Texas Technical University just published a report this past week that said the infidelity of a parent in the marriage relationship is the greatest influence on predicting a child's infidelity. So children will look at their parents and say, mom had an affair, Dad had an affair. What's the big deal? I'll have an affair. So the way that parents model is extremely important as far as how things are going to go with their kids. That's why it says adultery leads to death. Ashley Madison says life is short, have an affair. Solomon would say life is short. Adultery is going to make it a lot shorter and more miserable. And none who ever go this path will attain the paths of life, it says. Now, does this mean this is an unforgivable sin? No. It's not an unforgivable. The only unforgivable sin is unbelief in Christ and saying, you know, I will not accept the offering that you made on the cross on my behalf. That's the only unforgivable sin. But what I think it is getting at here is an affair, an adultery, will send you to the hospital, the spiritual hospital, with serious injuries. And multiple affairs will send you to the veterans hospital where you never get out and you are hurt permanently. Now, the morally shrewd are rewarded. The morally shrewd, it says, these are the people who will attain life, verses 20 to 22. For the upright will live in the land and the blameless will remain in it. But the wicked will be cut off from the land, and the unfaithful will be torn from it. So it says, walk in the ways of good men. Walk in the paths of the upright. And good is rarely glamorous. Good doesn't get press or notoriety. Good rarely gets rewarded. But good is eternal. Good lasts. And it says, the upright will live in the land. Do you know, when I was a kid, my favorite monsters were Kaltiki, the brain from the planet Eros, and the skeleton in the house on Haunted Hill. Now my favorite monsters are zombies and vampires, because zombies and vampires better illustrate what the real monsters are. When my kids were small, they would say to me at night, Dad, are monsters real? And I would say, yes and no. I said, the blob? No. Frankenfish? No. That's not real. But what I'm going to tell you now is even more scary. The real monsters look just like me. The real monsters many times wear nice suits, and they wear a nice conservative tie. They have a nice haircut, at least the hair that's there to cut. And many times the real monsters in life have a nice smile. Sometimes my daughter and I will go to Hot Topic. And she picked out a shirt. She says, Dad, that's your t-shirt up there. And she pointed it out, and it's a black t-shirt with white lettering that says, all monsters are human. And I go, yes. I would wear that, except that that doesn't do very well as far as making relational bridges, you know. But I agree with that. Solomon was warning both his son and all of Israel, watch out for evil men and evil women. Watch out for how they are going to try and lead you astray. Through the words of Scripture, he's warning us this morning. And now, parents, grandparents, I'd want to ask you, who's warning your children? Who's warning your grandchildren? Hopefully you are. Are your kids prepared to meet the zombies and the vampires out there? Because they're real. And it's going to be hard for them to tell apart because they look just like us. Are your kids prepared? Are you? Let's close in prayer. Father, many times in Scripture, very intimate subjects are addressed. Difficult things. And Proverbs chapter 2 is one of those chapters. It convicts me. It makes me see how I have failed. Father, I love my kids. I don't want them to fail. Father, for those of us here who are parents and grandparents, we have a responsibility to our kids, just as this was addressed from Solomon to a child saying, my son, my son. We need to be addressing our kids. There are certain subjects that have to be talked about. Father, give us the wisdom to know how to address these subjects, how to say things to our children to protect them from the real monsters that are out there. It's in Christ's name we pray.